it just kind of made you feel valid as a person. It made you feel that what you felt, it was okay to feel that way. You didn't have to be happy all the time, or it was great to be miserable but still go out and dance, you know, swing your cardigan around. You know, because it was great. Dancing was just the best thing, wasn't it? Oh, it was fantastic.
St Peter's Fields is a small corner of Manchester that is forever revolutionary. On the 16th of August 1819, cavalry charged into a peaceful gathering of 80,000 people demanding parliamentary reform. 18 people were thought to have been killed, hundreds injured, and the Peterloo Massacre became seared into our national consciousness. Later, the Free Trade Hall was built on the site, where, in the summer of 1976, a small revolution occurred when the Sex Pistols played two gigs in quick succession. The first cost 60p to get into, and around 40 people were there. Let's not get bogged down in the never-ending speculation and debate over who was actually there. The simple truth is that those present at those electrifying evenings were people who wouldn't just form the advance guard of the next wave of Mancunian music. Peter Hook, Bernard Sumner, Ian Curtis, Stephen Morrissey, Pete Shelley, Marquis Smith, Howard Devoto, Paul Morley, Tony Wilson, but would also bring forth an entirely new music scene in Britain, one built on a rejection of all that was slick, empty and metropolitan about the coming decade, one which embraced mystery, individuality, melancholy, wit, kitchen sink realism, and above all, independence.
What punk did was it kicked open all the doors, smashed down a few walls, which allowed people who were not punk to come through.
The punk scene changed music, obviously, and it was very raw when it first happened. And I think a lot of the things that came off the back of punk were certainly better in my eyes.
One of the many curiosities about punk is that this tsunami of sonic rage against the corporate music business was, in fact, largely funded by the corporate music industry. The Clash were on CBS. The Sex Pistols did their best to get signed and then swiftly dropped by almost every major label in Britain. And Epic, Polydor, United Artists and all the rest had their share of punk acts. This sat uneasily with some, not least The Clash, whose 1980 single Hitsville UK was a heartfelt tribute to the passion and principle of the emerging independent labels in Britain, as compared to the mutants, creeps and muscle men of the majors.
I suppose you tended to think of the big labels as being rapacious and probably not too interested in the artistic output, more interested in, well, obviously more interested in profits than the smaller labels. I mean, they were there, the small labels really weren't making any money, so they were doing it for artistic reasons. So I think there was that feeling, although obviously with The Clash, seeing things like Hitsville and of course the complete control there, the song about the wrangling with the CBS over what to release as a single, and yet there they are signed to CBS, one of the biggest record labels in the world.
By contrast, the new labels were often the brainchild of one committed visionary acting out of artistic zeal rather than greed. The ethic was not just DIY out of necessity, it was an explicit rejection of the London music biz. Even when the labels were based in London, such as Daniel Miller's Mute, Ivor Watts-Russell's 4AD or Jeff Travis's Rough Trade, they were a million miles, ideologically, if not literally, from the West End offices of EMI and their ilk. And just as many were located far from the capital, intentionally placed to celebrate local talent and cussedness. Furthest north, in Glasgow, Alan Horn intended Postcard Records to be, quote, a punk rock version of the Chic Organisation, a place where spikiness and hedonistic pure pop could meet and showcase the sound of young Scotland, a nod to Berry Gordy's Motown and their slogan, The Sound of Young America. Postcard Records had an aesthetic that was both glacially cool and infectiously silly. The records came in sleeves that were knowingly festooned with tea towel and shortbread tin Caledonian iconography, featuring cats, bagpipes, kilts and tartan. The records themselves, by the likes of Orange Juice, Joseph K and Aztec Camera, were oblique, elegant and charming. Along the M8 in Edinburgh, Bob Last's Fast Product put out influential early singles by the Gang of Four, the Mekons and the Human League. In Newcastle, Kitchenware had a small roster of bands such as Prefab Sprout and Martin Stevenson and the Dainties with songs that were crafted and quirky. From Liverpool came Bill Drummond's Zoo Records and bands like Echo and the Bunnymen, Wah Heat and the Teardrop Explodes, heady, crazed and psychedelic.
Music press that kept identifying things, you know, whether it be the Sound of Young Scotland or the New Mersey beat, you know, with Echo and the Bunnymen and Teardrop Explodes, and they'd always want a bandwagon to either create or jump on. So, you know, once it had been Manchester, it was going to be Glasgow and Edinburgh, then it was going to be Liverpool. Poor old Birmingham misses out, left in the world of heavy metal, really, as far as the music press was concerned. So there was never the Sound of Young Brum, sadly.
Even in Edinburgh, there was 53rd and 3rd, a label which gave us the shop assistance. Smallish bands like that in Glasgow, the BMX Bandits. But of course then the Jesus Mary Chain exploded out of East Kilbride. And then Primal Scream, who are still with us. But Primal Scream were a jangly indie act in 84, 85. Going to a gig, a small, intimate, sweaty gig was absolutely part of that scene, yeah. Going to gigs and then, of course, trawling around the independent record shops, some of which have survived, some of which haven't, of course.
These records were made in different cities by very different kinds of people, but they shared more than just idealistic notions about payment, distribution and shareholders. There was also an indie sound. In contrast to the lush, padded-shouldered, widescreen vision of transatlantic pop, the huge, gated reverb drum sound of Phil Collins, Pat Benatar, Duran Duran and their peers, indie was slim, spiky, jangly, skinny, and frequently harked back to a classic 60s template or the angular funkiness of post-punk. Indie offered a different narrative to the one that's generally seen as the story of the 1980s. Indie meant vintage clothes, old records, bedsits, Penguin Modern Classics, black and white movies, rather than the champagne, file of faxes and outsized mobile phones of Thatcher's children.
It sounds almost cliched now, but there was that element of you were becoming part of a club on the margins of things rather than at the epicentre, which offered us Lionel Richie and Phil Collins and Queen. And as far as we were concerned, they were absolutely the enemy. They were bland. There was just a sort of pandemic of awfulness. And here was indie music offering a clever, amusing, thrilling alternative to that.
A lot of people weren't just following the charts, you know. They were listening to late night shows like the John Peel show and listening to some of the stuff he was playing. So there was a lot going on outside of that mainstream music.
I think there was a counterculture and largely, to an extent, divided along regional lines. Even then, the political landscape and map was divided north and south. And the north of England could be aligned politically and culturally, I think, with Scotland.
Glasgow was like all northern cities struggling, very high unemployment at the time, very grey.
Oh, it just looked like an industrial wreckage. You know, we like empty shipyards on one side, a city centre that was starting to really fall apart by that point. It just wasn't a very nice place to be.
Like all the cities, it was a lot of people unemployed and a lot of very unhappy people.
I remember growing up in quite a divisive era. There were riots in Liverpool, there were riots in Moss Side. And I just remember it seemed even as like as a really young child, the country didn't seem at peace with itself.
Where I lived was an old mining town and there was nothing and it just went downhill so quickly.
When you're in a recession, people's imaginations come to the fore and you had some incredible bands and music coming out of the back end of the 1970s into the early 80s.
Perhaps those moments in time, those years when things are really difficult, perhaps that sparks youthful creativity in terms of culture, in terms of music, maybe art. Look at the huge surge in indie music, I guess what became Britpop later on. These creative surges were happening more in one genre, more in one way.
People like the Jesus and Mary Chain coming from East Kilbride and Teenage Fan Club from Bells Hill. All these kind of wee outlying areas of Glasgow have started to produce this amazing music and these amazing, exciting bands that were local. There was definitely a sense of pride in that, you know, you were just kind of like, ah, that's great, they're from here, sort of a thing. Yes!
It was, at times, a pretty bleak time. And from that kind of 80s turmoil and that kind of sense of injustice, I think you can see the edginess that that gave to some of the musicians that then started to come through from Manchester in the 1980s.
Back at the Lesser Free Trade Hall in 1976, three of the four members of what would become Joy Division were present at those Sex Pistols gigs. Peter Hook and Bernard Sumner had been schoolmates since they were 11, although they went to the show separately. It was a moment of epiphany. Sumner later said that the gig destroyed the myth of being a pop star, of a musician being some kind of god that you had to worship. The following day, Hook borrowed £35 from his mother to buy his first bass. Ian Curtis of Macclesfield saw the second Pistols show and was similarly inspired. Together, they formed a band called Warsaw and played their first gig on 29th of May 1977, supporting the Buzzcocks. It was reviewed in NME by one Paul Morley, another attendee of the Pistols Free Trade Hall gig. The burgeoning indie scene was an incestuous nexus of people and ideas. Warsaw became Joy Division, and their debut album, Unknown Pleasures, became the 10th release on Manchester's Factory Records, the defiantly unorthodox and enigmatic label that grew out of a club night in Hume run by another present at those Sex Pistols shows. Tony Wilson was a Cambridge graduate who'd come back to his native city to work for Granada TV. Opinionated, mouthy, bright, fired up by punk rock, English literature and situationism, his importance to the renaissance of Northern music and the indie culture cannot be overestimated. Yet another of those present in that tiny throng at the Lesser Free Trade Hall was Martin Hannett. His production on Unknown Pleasures was, along with the music, a revelation. Austere, brooding, menacing, ghostly, melancholic, beautiful. Radio.
I remember first hearing Joy Division quite distinctly because I'd bought the first album, Unknown Pleasures, and I'd never heard them at the time. I think I must have picked up on the buzz in the music press, and I sent my check off to Factory Records, having seen their advert in the back of Sounds or whatever paper, and soon enough came back a cardboard parcel. So I put it on and I thought, well, this is quite different from anything I've heard before. It's not punk, but it is something I can relate to still, so I was entranced by that album.
Manchester in the late 70s still bore the dust and the rubble of the Industrial Revolution and the Second World War, and this was the city that Unknown Pleasures enshrined in sound. Haunted throughout by splintering glass, industrial hums, the whooshing and clanking of traffic in the rain on the Mancunian Way, or lifts ascending desolate Hume tower blocks. But there's more than that. Before moving to the inner city, Ian Curtis had lived near Macclesfield, and John Savage, the writer, is correct when he talks of the witchy emptiness of the Pennines weighing heavy upon Joy Division, ensuring the definitive Northern Gothic statement.
Confusion in her eyes, it says it all. She's lost control. And she's clinging to the nearest passerby.
that feeling of that desolate city centre that Manchester was, there's a lot of buildings defunct, there was no money coming into the city then. Joy Division and your proper post-punkers, which I got heavily into then, you know, your Joy Divisions, your Killing Jokes, your Blue Orchids, The Fall, of course, they summed up that disaffected city beautifully.
There is a sort of gothic feel to it, and it's a lot of people think of Joy Division as very much an urban sound, but I think you can also listen to it and hear desolate landscapes and stuff.
I think Joy Division's music did reflect what we imagined them as coming from, you know, Manchester as imagined. I mean, at that point in my life, I'd never been to Manchester. But once bands like Joy Division started becoming popular, you started to see Manchester on the television. It was definitely a northern sound, I think, you know, and quite distinctive. We were always aware that there was a Manchester scene, you know, people like the Buzzcocks and Magazine, you know, they weren't London bands, they were Manchester bands. And that was quite clear to us down at the other end of the country.
Tony Wilson gave Joy Division their first TV appearance on Granada in July 1979. 2 months later, they appeared on the BBC, live from Manchester's Oxford Road studios. They played two songs, She's Lost Control and Transmission, throughout which Curtis, seemingly in another world, twitched and twisted his way, jerked like a puppet by the angular rhythms and riffs. Everyone who saw the show was transfixed. It remains one of the most extraordinary, visceral and compelling pieces of music television ever.
That was the first time I'd actually seen them physically performing. He was quite different from anybody I'd seen before. He seemed to have an intensity and was internalising what he was singing. That's what he was doing, I think. You know, instead of reaching out to the audience, it's almost as if he was singing it to himself in his strange, jerky dancing. He's almost wrapping his arms around himself. He's not really playing the role of the rock star at all. That was what hit home.
A lot of bands and artists, they have a sort of stage persona, which is really just an act. But with Joy Division, it was the real thing. Ian Curtis had epilepsy, he had depression, and of course he committed suicide. So when you listen to Joy Division, you're not listening to pretend angst, it's the real thing. And if you've ever seen footage of him live, the way he's jerking about and with his eyes staring wildly into space, you know that that is the real thing. He's not playing up, he's not acting.
Following Ian's death, the remaining members of Joy Division formed New Order, bringing synths, sequences and a new dance sound to Wilson's Factory Records, and with it, what is considered to be the biggest selling 12-inch single in history.
They sort of morphed into New Order, which I was much more aware of. And New Order was, you take the sort of slightly doom-laden songs of Joy Division, which are extremely powerful, and then they go to New York and they discover dance music and they think, right, let's start putting synthesizers on our tracks. Let's put a drum machine on here. And I think a lot of people who are into Joy Division probably had a real surprise when New Order became that.
Joy Division was so much, you know, the personality of Ian Curtis was so dominant within them. I thought, well, I wonder how they're going to make this work. Are they being a bit too daring here? But obviously they did make it work.
When I first heard Blue Monday by New Order, and I remember Annie Nightingale playing that and being just mesmerised by it and feeling like everything was different.
In my sort of childhood and late teens, I did do Morris dancing. Not the stick with the bells around your ankles, but Morris dancing a bit like cheerleaders. We had very traditional tunes that we would dance to. And you used to go around to different areas and you'd be watching different groups perform. Then that would be a competition, see who got the prize. And one group, rather than having the traditional, you know, band kind of music, they had Blue Monday, which was, it was really good to keep the step.
How does it feel?
The great thing about New Order is that they were played in goth clubs, they were played in the sort of indie clubs, they were played everywhere. So again, they sort of seem to encapsulate so many different tastes and tribes.
One would imagine that as a music-obsessed Mancunian, Stephen Patrick Morrissey, also present at that second Sex Pistols show, was watching Joy Division's seminal TV appearance in 1979. He was a well-known, if unusual, figure on the city scene. He was obsessed with the New York Dolls and 1960s girl groups, an inveterate letter writer to the NME, and had produced a pulpish biography of James Dean. Tony Wilson said of him to the journalist Ian Watson in 2003.
He was the specky kid in the corner, the clever little swatty outsider boy, very brilliant. He wrote a fantastic short play about eating toast, and I think he gave it to me and I lost it. Then at some point, whenever it was in 1980, he phoned me up and said, "Would you come and see me?" I drove out to King's Road, Stretford, to his mum's house, went to his bedroom upstairs and sat on the edge of the bed while he sat on the chair, surrounded by James Dean posters, and he informed me that he decided to become a pop star. I sort of went, "Well, Stephen, that's very interesting." And inside I was thinking, "You're the least likely rock and roll star imaginable in the universe."
Events were to prove Wilson wrong, of course, as he would happily acknowledge. A precociously talented guitarist called Johnny Marr knocked on Morrissey's door, said this is how Lieber and Stoller met, and suggested they form a band. One of the first decisions was that the Smiths would sign to an independent label. Marr said that this was an important aesthetic statement in itself.
I do think that it was important they were on an indie label, because I think an awful lot of time we, you know, even after the Smiths, we would only listen to music that was on an independent label. We didn't want to hear music that we could hear on Radio 1, you know, in the charts. We wanted the alternative music. It's a kind of a snobbery, really. We're kind of not interested if it's mainstream.
The Smiths did not, as many predicted, sign to Factory. They went with the workers' cooperative Rough Trade, described by Richard King as the independent sector's conscience, shop floor and corn market. The label grew out of the Rough Trade shop, opened by Jeff Travis in West London in February 1976, and whose idealistic, leftist, communitarian ethos had nurtured unorthodox rock and roll from the likes of Scritti Politti, Swell Maps and Vic Goddard and the Subway Sect. The Smiths' first single, Hand in Glove, began with a wailing harmonica, possibly a sly nod to Love Me Do and the beginning of the Beatles' career.
I do distinctly remember walking across Manchester with my boyfriend, and the line sort of, you know, from Hand in Glove, you know, we may be hidden by rags, but that we have something that they'll never have. And feeling terribly pleased with myself because I had that life, and, you know, you talk in quotes, and we were probably profoundly irritating to be around. But the Smiths were just everything.
Few bands can have entered the public consciousness as swiftly, strikingly, or as fully formed as the Smiths. Drummer Mike Joyce said of their very first rehearsal that he knew instantly he was in the best band in the world. They came draped in gladioli, diamante, beads and controversy, with songs about the Moors murders, vegetarianism and unorthodox, shadowy sexuality. They chose their name to be deliberately plain and unvarnished, in contrast with the glamour and flamboyance of their music. It was their second single, This Charming Man, that seemed to be their earliest statement of intent. Chiming, plangent, vivacious, unusual, and with one of the great opening lines of all time. Punctured bicycle on a hillside desolate. Six words, at least four of which were rarely heard in a pop lyric.
Punctured bicycle on a hillside desolate.
Back in 83, 84, 85, I was a callow teenager, and the Smiths arrived in my consciousness and transformed me.
my sister had been off to university and she came home after her first or second term. And we sat down and she said, watch this. And it was an in-concert. And this was the Smiths from Derby or somewhere. And I was just transfixed.
They played in Derby and I remember they gave tickets away. It was being recorded for the whistle test. I remember they played This Charming Man, I think it was three times, because Morrissey got a flower in his eye. The reason he got a flower in his eye, because all these people were given tickets in Derby, and as we went in, we were given bunches of flowers. And at a certain key point in This Charming Man, we were signalled to throw the flowers. Morrissey got one in the eye, and they had to redo it again. It was like a cult that was almost being invented in front of my eyes anyway.
He was this curious, bequiffed figure with his all flailing arms and these wonderful songs, and I was utterly bewitched by them, yeah.
I'd seen the Smiths on Top of the Pops, but I think I was just too young at 10 or whenever, and it wasn't until I reached 14, whether it was my hormones, something happened, and they spoke to me. It was like an epiphany. They made sense to me. They spoke of my kind of unhappiness, my concerns, all those things that you were kind of dealing with as a teenager that you didn't really want to talk to anyone about, but there was someone singing about them and it made you normal.
Yes, there was that sort of, you know, obsessional, almost archetypal teenage response to it, or a particular type of teenager that, you know, teenagers are slightly awkward and introverted. I was locked in the bedroom playing the first album.
When The Queen Is Dead came out, I just did not stop listening to it for the whole of that summer, you know, just immersing myself, lying at home on my bed and doing that typical teenage thing of just listening and just immersing myself in every song and feeling a bit tragic, because they were great to feel tragic too.
I think there was only one other at school who sort of shared this fascination, and we became encamped, and we were in one camp and the prog rockers and the hair metalists were in the other, and never the twain met.
And if you didn't love the Smiths, you weren't alternative. It was just as simple as that. You made a choice. You loved the Smiths, you didn't love the Smiths, and then you were into chart music.
The mainstream music was listened to by the girls at school we didn't want to be friends with, or wouldn't let us be friends with them. You know, there was very much a segregation in our musical tastes as well as our social tastes.
Of course, these days, David Cameron likes the Smiths, we all like the Smiths. But at the time, when the Smiths first came around, they were a bit odd. And to be honest, if you were growing up in a sort of conservative place and I grew up, you probably wouldn't particularly publicise yourself as a Smiths fan.
I always liked the words to a miserable life. Love is just a miserable life, because that's what I felt at that time, because nobody loved me. Or, you know, that's how you feel. I'm sure somebody loved me, but they just didn't tell me. It'd be nice to think so. That whole unrequited love thing, and you're a teenager, it's all happening for you. And Morrissey just encapsulated that in his words, and Johnny Marr's guitars, they just are so joyful. And it's that dichotomy between those seemingly miserable lyrics, they're not really miserable, they're actually really quite funny, and this incredibly joyous sound of guitars, and just, oh, it just sets the heather alight, doesn't it? It's just amazing.
My daughter, Louisa, she just loved the Smiths. Heaven knows I'm miserable now. So I was walking up the stairs, it'd be playing over and over and over again. I mean, it was constant. But in the end, me and my husband were actually singing along.
When I was about 15, 16, listening to the Smiths for the first time, it was the lyrics. You know, his lyrics just hit because I was a sensitive soul, you know. And they weren't angry. They weren't like, I'm going to smash everything up lyrics. It was sort of, oh, you know, I'm suffering inside because I feel isolated and I don't understand the world around me.
Where I lived, it was just outside Glasgow and there was just nothing to do. It was desolate. I cannot tell you how awful. There was just nothing there. You just really felt isolated. And I think the appeal of Morrissey's lyrics, I mean, God, does that speak to you if you're sitting in a council house, you know, in the middle of nowhere with absolutely nothing to do?
And I understand that people will talk about his lyrics as being deep and meaningful and with tongue in cheek. He's a very good lyricist, but I still find it music that poor, depressed, lonely students sit at home feeling woe is me, and listening to that doesn't help. seriously, turn it off. Put some Donna Summer on.
There was always humour, I thought, because when people used to say, oh, they're miserable, and I never understood it because the lyrics had so much humour in them. And just the way that he presented himself as well had a lot of humour. It was self-deprecating as well as arrogant.
And Morrissey is an interesting character, and he can be a bit of an arse sometimes in some of the things he says. But sometimes he says some things that really do hit the spot in terms of a particular message about people or politics or animals.
I think I thought everything he said was right. When Meat is Murder came out, I turned vegetarian because Morrissey said it was wrong, and I listened to Meat is Murder and sort of wept. So I think I sort of thought he was right about everything, which is why it was all a bit disappointing when I realised he was a bit wrong about things a bit later on. But certainly at the time, for being a teenager, he seemed like the voice of reason. I haven't actually eaten beef yet since 1986.
My boyfriend at the time, for my 15th birthday, bought me The Queen is Dead. I still have it. It's one of my most treasured possessions. He doesn't even like The Smiths particularly, so I understand what a truly generous gift that was. But he is now my husband, so we've known each other for 20-odd years, and I've probably still love Morrissey longer than I've loved him, but we won't tell him about that.
I do like to hear lyrics that are really clever, and some of the things that Morrissey comes out with. There's the famous one from The Queen is Dead, where he talks about breaking into Buckingham Palace, and the Queen meets him, and she says something like, "I know you, and you can't sing," and he says, "That's nothing, you should hear me play piano." And again, if you look at that, it's a political message, it's a Republican message, but it's told with great wit. If you can combine a great message with an entertaining wit as well, I mean, what more can you ask for?
And I think there was that celebration of being clever that unites the Fall and a New Order and the Smiths, obviously, but also a sense of, I suppose, irreverence. And there was always a rather downbeat Manchester wit, which sort of got on your nerves after a time a bit. There was, everything was ironic, everything was deadpan.
Manchester always seemed very industrial, very grey. I guess I got that impression from a lot of the music, a lot of Smith's lyrics talk about the humdrum towns. You can only assume that Morrissey was writing about the town he grew up in. So I imagined it to be rainy and quite miserable. But musically, it was the place we all wanted to go.
It felt like a soundtrack, definitely. As you walked around with these amazing, great big red brick buildings, you just felt it went with the city, definitely. The lyrics went with the city, the sound went with the city. And I did feel, I suppose, subconsciously, that I was in the right place at the right time. And I felt very, very lucky about that, really.
Of course, at that time, Manchester was the epicentre of the musical universe. This was like a pilgrimage to see the Smiths on their home patch. It was just wonderful. This was the absolute apex of following them. And to get down to the front towards the climax of their set, edging my way through the hordes, just sensational.
People were jumping about a lot, as they usually are at gigs, and he threw his shirt into the audience and people went a bit mad for a scramble of a fragment of Morrissey's shirt.
Towards the end of the set, Morrissey hurled his sweat-soaked shirt into the audience. That provoked the usual violent scrum to try and seize a piece of it. And I joined in that scrum. And then many, many months later, it transpired that that scene of desperate, frenzied seizure of his shirt had been photographed. And it was extraordinary to receive a phone call from a friend of mine, my sort of fellow Smith's apostle, saying, Andrew, you're on the gatefold sleeve of the Smiths album. The gatefold sleeve of their live album Rank. And of course, that I could scarcely believe it. That just didn't seem possible. But there we are. There it is, my image etched on the gatefold sleeve as an 18-year-old suede head.
He was a very clever man, I think. He knew how to tap the nation's youth and their subconscious. He'd obviously spent many years there himself, because you can't do what he did without that, you know, without having been there. Sitting in your bedroom for years on end with a library and a TV with four channels, and not really a hell of a lot else except for, you know, your own head, yeah, he knew what it was like. So, you know, he obviously used it to his advantage.
The Smiths' records were immediately embraced by a generation shivering their way through the economic wasteland of the 1980s, informed as they were by kitchen sink drama, films like Saturday Night and Sunday Morning and Billy Liar, and writers like Sheila Delaney, Victoria Wood and Alan Bennett.
I always was interested in those books and films anyway, you know, Saturday Night, Sunday Morning, Billy Liar and Taste of Honey, and I loved them all. So I was interested in those references and I got them. I think he was very interested in working class culture, and although he was quite highbrow in some ways, he appreciated lowbrow things as well.
I sought out these things and I bought videos of Saturday Night and Sunday Morning, The L-Shaped Room. In fact, I even tracked down a copy of the book Spend, 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 which was the book about Viv Nicholson's Pools win, and it was her image which adorned the cover of Heaven Knows I'm Miserable. That was a treasure, you know, to find this old, in fact, it was an old library copy. And I thought, you know, I had unearthed a real nugget.
I think it was also wanting to get out of where you were. It was an escape for your own time. AIDS and all that were happening in the 80s as well. And before that, we had the Cold War. And I spent the late 70s worrying about the Cold War, then to move on to AIDS. And so all that kind of 1960s and 50s stuff, it just seemed a lot simpler. There was that wee period in history where it just seemed just a wee bit safer to be in. And I think that was probably quite comforting when you're like 13, 14.
You had Morrissey with his references to 60s literature, the kitchen sink dramas, the films and so on. But then you had Johnny Marr. He drew from this wide repertoire, but together it was just a magnificent combination. Absolutely magnificent.
The Smiths came to embody the independent guitar culture with one release in particular. How Soon Is Now is probably the Smiths' best-known song, if not their most representative, hovering somewhere opaquely between psychedelia, R&B and the dance floor. Johnny Marr himself has described it as possibly our most enduring record. It's most people's favourite, I think. It combines the Smiths at their most imaginative and magisterial as a band, soaring, meshing guitars drifting in and out like smoke and light over a shifting Bo Diddley groove, with perhaps the ultimate Morrissey lyric, a compressed, oblique tale of unfulfillment and northern nightlife littered with casual gems of imagery and observation.
I remember very vividly hearing How Soon Is Now on Peel and just being stunned and just thinking, wow, that is a sound. I think it was that searing guitar sound, that fabulous Johnny Marr sound that just absolutely poleaxed me. And I remember standing there just listening to it.
As regards records, I think How Soon Is Now, it's just such a fabulous record. Even now, it just, from the minute it starts to the minute it finishes, it's there, a complete package. And that's what grabbed me, just the feel of it.
One phrase particularly seems to distill Morrissey's whole, mournful, sly, self-pitying worldview, and perhaps that of all indie music, into one glorious, pathetic creed de coeur.
It's one of those songs, How Soon Is Now, it makes me stop and I have to listen to it. Those lyrics are melodramatic, but you are melodramatic when you're 14, 15, you know, you are completely self-absorbed, aren't you? And it's that kind of thing when you went out, when you were interested in boys and you'd go out to evenings and be so desperately shy, you couldn't speak to anybody and you would go home again and nothing would have happened, even though your crush was there, you just couldn't bring yourself to speak to them. So it's very evocative of that excruciating time.
My wife loves this story. I hated the Smiths, right? I thought they were bloody awful. I liked two songs of the Smiths. The rest of it I thought was a load of moaning student crap, not to put too fine a point on it. In 2004, we were flicking through the TV and they had a gig on, and it was Morrissey, in fact. I said, oh, Christ, not him. Two songs in, I was gripped. I thought, oh my God, I've missed so much. So now, the Smiths, who've been broken up since I was 25, you know, I love them. And Karen laughs at me all the time. She says, oh, well, of course, you know, I've liked this since 1985. I said, well, of course you did, student, you know, all that kind of stuff. But it just goes to show, all the time, you never know when you're going to hear the next great song, you know?
Many years later, I asked Morrissey, by now a solo artist, whether he had heard the briefly notorious duo Tattoo's version of How Soon Is Now. Yes, it was magnificent, he said. Absolutely. I don't know much about them. They're the teenage Russian lesbians, I replied. Well, said Morrissey, aren't we all? By the 90s, indie had come to mean something else, something much less unusual and underground, much less vulnerable and outsider. But along the way of that revolutionary process, which began in the wake of punk, we saw an exciting, energising development in the late 1980s, where indie music and the emerging rave culture intertwined, coalescing around dance clubs like The Hacienda, a former warehouse in Manchester, and epitomised by the bands of the so-called Madchester scene, notably the Stone Roses and the Happy Mondays. It was further fuel to Manchester and the North's reputation as a vibrant musical epicentre.
We used to dance to the Stone Roses at the Ritz on a Monday night. They paved that way for that crossover, and I sort of retired my docks. And I do remember I bought a pair of Fila trainers and started going to dance clubs, and it all changed.
In my day, he says wistfully, looking back at the 80s, it was very much a case of there's indie music and then there's the rest. There's been a discernible crossover. I think that was largely helped by developments in the sort of late 80s when indie and dance seemed to converge. Certain indie music has led me onto soul music, Motown, a broadening of horizons, which I didn't necessarily have in 1984 or 1985 when it was indie or nothing.
I think Primal Scream's album, the whole Loaded thing, that was massively important. Stone Roses, Happy Mondays. And then everybody, I suppose, who'd been into just indie music, then it sort of gave us permission to look beyond the obvious. And I suddenly started getting into Marvin Gaye and Stevie Wonder and finding all this stuff that I just hadn't thought about because I'd been far too busy being, you know, cerebral. And gosh, that was it. I was off. I was going dancing, definitely.
Indie music in the early 90s, you start off 1990, you've got Baggy at its height, and everybody thought, this is it, Stone Roses are going to become the new Rolling Stones, the new Beatles. And then it didn't happen. And then suddenly grunge lands on the British Isles, and everybody is into grunge. Nirvana, Pearl Jam, and inevitably there was a backlash. And that develops eventually into things like the Britpop thing and bands like Pulp and Blur and Oasis.
The whole Manchester thing, whilst a bit tongue-in-cheek and a bit of a joke, was about a lot of things. It wasn't just about rave music, it wasn't about Hacienda, it was about bands around at the time, it was different types of music that were all coming out of the woodwork. It was such an exciting time music-wise. It was so creative. That continued, that didn't just stop. I personally think that continued till the later 90s when it took a different turn. I think that creativity got used for something else and perhaps got used politically, and I think a lot of people didn't like that.
The narrative arc of indie going into the heart of the mainstream is best illustrated by the tale of Alan McGee's Creation label. Its first release was a single by a music journalist, The Legend, and originally creation was the home of all that was fey, weird and out of step. Bands like the Jasmine Minx and the Jazz Butcher and Biff Bang Pow, but then Felt and then Primal Scream and eventually Oasis, who bestrode 90s pop like boorish colossi playing loud, laddish indie rock. When you're the biggest band in Britain and are being invited to receptions at Downing Street, clearly indie means something very different from what it did in 1979.
Indie is a way of life. We'd still wear Doc Martens and striped tights, or we would still always opt for that kind of slightly alternative, off-piste viewpoint on maybe politics or anything, you know. Maybe we were always like that. I don't know whether the music's changed us. Maybe it's just given us a voice.
Indie music in the 80s, it was a sort of culture. There was an indie culture. Nowadays, indie bands who have an indie rock or an indie pop sound will often be signed to big record companies.
I think certainly indie bands are different now, because you were indie in the 80s because you were different, and now it's sort of a genre on its own.
I think there was a preciousness and exclusivity about indie music which wasn't necessarily healthy. It was willfully excluding other things.
What teenager's going to sit in a room nowadays and spend 3 hours listening to one record? It's a different world. And I don't think indie as it was exists anymore, which is sad. But then good in a way, I suppose, because I'd like to think there's no more really morose teenagers sitting in their bedrooms thinking, God, what will I do next? I've already read that book.
You know, listening to the radio now, I'm happy that my children are hearing different kinds of music and actually have access to that. It has become more mainstream, I think, but that's got to be a good thing.
Tony Wilson died of cancer at the tragically young age of 57 in 2007. The Union flag on Manchester Town Hall was lowered to half-mast as a mark of respect and as an acknowledgement of how Wilson had helped with the renaissance of the city from a benighted post-industrial wasteland to a glamorous, cosmopolitan centre, one of the artistic capitals of the world. Manchester has the largest student population in Europe, and many of them come from all over the world, drawn by the music and the culture that Wilson and the independent pioneers forged and fostered. A process begun, though seen by hardly anyone, at the Free Trade Hall on a hot summer night in 1976.
When I went to Manchester for my interview for university, I was kind of like, oh my God, this is just as dank as Glasgow is, do you know that way? Now, I went to Manchester a couple of years ago and I was just like, oh my goodness, is this the same city? It must be the same feeling if you went to Glasgow in the 80s and now come back and are just like, it's clean, it's fresh, it's bizarre. They have definitely evolved in the same way.
You'd suddenly see 300 luxury 1 to 2 bedroom executive apartments suddenly being built. You know, what they were doing around Manchester, Piccadilly Station was an example of that. Buildings going up, the Metrolink being extended.
It'd gone from being a very old, slightly grimy, but romantic city. You could see why Morrissey wrote such fascinating lyrics about it. Into this, wow, where have all these buildings come from?
It's always hard to resist painting a stereotype of us northerners, oop ear, bashing ourselves over the heads with dustbin lids. It wasn't that bleak, but it was clearly a series of areas that, to put it positively, needed development. And I've got a great admiration for the councils of the Northwest in actually how they led the regeneration. What Manchester is today, it's completely different from what Manchester was just before the Commonwealth Games, which itself is far more developed and advanced than it was, you know, 20 years ago.
When I was applying to universities, my friends and I, everyone wanted to go to Manchester or Leeds or Sheffield. North was the place to be. It was considered cool and edgy. It was where all the good music was coming from.
I think when I decided to go to Manchester, people genuinely thought that I was going to a cool city. It always had kudos. Places like the Hacienda had given it a reputation of coolness, and although they didn't exist in the end of the 90s, there was this legacy of coolness that lived on.
There was a joyfulness about the North, which I know was quite weird, because I suppose that after years of people saying, oh, it's grim up North, and then that just all seemed to be blown away by this huge energy.
I'm Stuart Maconie, and in this episode you heard Madeline Hines, Bruce Austin, Michael Perry, Paul Cornish, Andrew Houston, Katrina Riddell, Carl Brooks, Andy Carter-Fee, Anthony Jagger, Chris Connolly, Den Cartledge, Steve Diamond, Joe Ward, Sue Ripley, Louisa Feeney, Stuart Whitehead, Andrew Marsh, Tina Garner, Martin Wigley, Mark James, Kevin Huff, Nadja Shireen and Karis Dorrit. From northern cities to Northern Ireland, next week, Life During the Troubles. The People's Songs is a Smooth Operations production.